camera.
Excuse me.
Mic leke aa raha, mic leke aa raha.
अभी सेंटर में रुके हैं, सेंटर
में
मैम यू लेफ्ट मैम यू मैम यू
Sir, left side.
Sir, left side, sir. Here.
मैम
यो मैम यो सर यो मैम यो मैम
हाँ यार लेफ्ट साइड ऑल ऑफ यू लेफ्ट
मैम यो मैम
मैडम यार लेफ्ट
मैडम यार मैम यो मैम यो मैम यो मैम यो मैम
उसका जी लेफ्ट साइड
सामने
मैम यो
मैम स्टेडियम
मैम यो
मैडम लेफ्ट
मैम यो
मैडम लेफ्ट साइड
भतीजा बोला सेंटर बोला सेंटर बोला मैम सेंटर
एक्सक्यूज मी माय माय दीपा
ये कहना चाहूँगा कि मैं ये कहना चाहूँगा कि जो किताब जो लिखी गई है वो एक लव स्टोरी, एक थ्रिलर और एक ख़ास टाइम पे सेट है, जो कि सेकेंड वर्ल्ड वॉर, दूसरे विश्व युद्ध का टाइम था, जब नेताजी सुभाष चंद्र बोस ने अपनी इंडियन नेशनल आर्मी बनाई थी। अब बहुत कुछ बोला जा रहा है सुभाष चंद्र बोस की इंडियन नेशनल आर्मी के बारे में, और सुभाष चंद्र बोस के उस काम पे, वो सही थे, गलत थे, वो हैं, वो नहीं हैं, वो मारे गए कि नहीं मारे गए, वो तमाम तरह की कॉन्ट्रोवर्सीज है। तो बहुत मज़ेदार किताब है, बहुत सही टाइम पे है, उसकी किताब की निकलने की टाइमिंग बहुत अच्छी है, बिकॉज बहुत सारे लोग उत्सुक हैं जानने के लिए कि ये क्या हुआ था। बट ये एक फिक्शनल किताब है और बहुत मज़ेदार, इट्स अ वेरी वेरी गुड रीड। तो जिनको हिस्ट्री की में दिलचस्पी है उनको मज़ा आएगा, जिनको एक लव स्टोरी, थ्रिलर बेस्ड लव स्टोरी और बहुत ही एक पीरियड में सेट फिक्शन में इंटरेस्ट है उनको भी मज़ा आएगा। तो दोनों तरह के बोथ काइंड ऑफ रीडर्स वुड एंजॉय दिस बुक। आई हैव जस्ट फिनिश शूटिंग रागदेश, उसकी एडिटिंग चल रही है, तो बहुत बहुत बड़ा सब्जेक्ट है। रागदेश बताएगा कि एक्चुअली हिंदुस्तान को आज़ादी मिली तो कैसे मिली, क्योंकि बहुत सारे मुगालते हैं, बहुत सारी चीज़ें हैं, बहुत सारी चीज़ों में पर्दा गिरा हुआ है, लोगों को पता नहीं है कि सुभाष चंद्र बोस, हमने बचपन में अपने किताबों में पढ़ा है सुभाष चंद्र बोस, लेकिन बहुत सारे लोग जानते नहीं सुभाष चंद्र बोस के काम के बारे में। तो वो बहुत बड़े लीडर थे, मुझे लगता है हिंदुस्तान के सबसे बड़े फ्रीडम फाइटर वही थे, मेरे हिसाब से देश को आज़ादी उन्होंने दिलाई है। रागदेश उसी के बारे में, हाँ, लेकिन मुझे ये वक्त अच्छा नहीं लगा, मुझे सिर्फ उसकी पोस्ट के बारे में बात की, ये टाइम में हर चीज़ का को मुद्दा बना देना, क्योंकि आपके पास एक ऐसा प्लेटफॉर्म है ट्विटर या कम्युनिकेशन के तहत, हर चीज़ को न्यूज़ बना देना, हर चीज़ को एक तूल को, हर चीज़ को तूल देना, तिल का पहाड़ बना देना, ये अच्छी बात नहीं है। वो तो मासूम सी लड़की है, उसने कुछ कहा तो उसको लेकर के इतने बड़े बड़े लोग उस पर कॉमेंट क्यों कर रहे हैं, उसको बच्चे का जीना आराम कर दिया आपने। मुझे तो बहुत बुरा लगता है, मैं बहुत असहाय फील करता हूँ, बहुत हेल्पलेस फील करता हूँ कि देश की मेजॉरिटी इस तरह की बात सोच रही है। तो मुझे लगता नहीं कि देश किसी अच्छी तरफ ये देश जा रहा है, तो मुझे अच्छा नहीं लगता बस।
यस,
कैसा
रहा पूरी सेरेमनी?
ऑस्कर एंटायर सेरेमनी बहुत अच्छी थी, हमेशा अच्छी लगती है, बहुत एलिगेंट होती है और हमको लगता है कि हमारे अवार्ड शोज ऐसे क्यों नहीं होते, हमारे अवार्ड शोज में इतनी भड़ैती की होती रहती है, इतना बॉयज़ और इतना एक रीगल और एक तमीज़ से क्यों नहीं करते हैं हम लोग। बट देखिए वहाँ भी इतना बड़ा फियास्को हो गया, तो ये भूलने की जो चीज़ है ना, जितना सोशल नेटवर्किंग साइज और जितने प्लेटफॉर्म्स कम्युनिकेट करने के लिए बनते जा रहे हैं इंसान उतना भूलता जा रहा है। देखिए उनसे भी गलती हो गई, उनसे वो ये ऐसी नहीं होती, और तरह की तमाम गलतियाँ होती हैं। आई वॉज वेरी हैप्पी दैट लाला लैंड डिड नॉट गेट द बेस्ट पिक्चर अवार्ड एंड मूनलाइट गॉट इट। तो जब लाला लैंड बोला था आई वॉज थोड़ा डिसअपॉइंटेड, बट व्हेन मूनलाइट गॉट इट मैंने कहा देखो देयर इज सम होप, देयर इज जस्टिस। थैंक यू वेरी मच।
नौमिता के साथ मैंने बहुत काम किया है, मैं उनसे बहुत डरती थी, तो जब इनका फोन आया और उन्होंने कहा कि मैंने किताब लिखी है क्या तुम लॉन्च करोगी, से पहले मैंने हाँ कर दी बिकॉज एडवर्टाइजिंग में मैंने बहुत काम किया है इनके साथ। इंडिया के सबसे बेहतरीन एड फिल्म मेकर्स में से ये जाने जाते हैं और तो मुझ में अब भी वो डर है इसीलिए मैंने तुरंत हाँ कर दी। सो इट वॉज रादर सिंपल टू गेट मी टू डू द बुक लॉन्च, बट आई एम ऑल्सो वेरी वेरी एक्साइटेड टू बी लॉन्चिंग नौमिता एंड संजय's बुक।
किस तरह की किताबें आप पढ़ती हैं? और
मैं पहले बहुत पढ़ती थी, अब मैं अनपढ़ हो गई हूँ फिल्म स्क्रिप्ट के अलावा बहुत पढ़ने का मौका नहीं मिलता, पर ये मुझे मज़ेदार इसलिए भी लगी क्योंकि जब हिस्ट्री से मैं ज़्यादा थोड़ी तंग आ जाती हूँ, तो अगर हिस्टोरिकल फिक्शन हो तो एक इमेजिनेशन का वहाँ स्कोप होता है कि आप सोचते हैं कि अच्छा ये तो हो रहा था पॉलिटिकली, हिस्ट्री कहता है कि ये हुआ, पर इंडिविजुअल्स के लाइफ्स में क्या हो रहा था दैट टाइम, दैट एक्साइट्स मी अ लॉट, व्हिच इज व्हाई आई थिंक दिस इज एंड इट्स अ वेरी ग्रिपिंग बुक। इसको फिल्म जरूर, दे शुड मेक इट इनटू अ फिल्म।
विद्या, आपको लगता है कि किताबों की, बुक्स की, ब्लैक एंड व्हाइट की अभी भी महत्वता उतनी है या फिर फिल्म्स और इंटरनेट सोशल नेटवर्किंग अब उतना ज्यादा आगे आ गया?
आई थिंक किताबें हमेशा रेलेवेंट रहेंगे। جن کو پڑھنا اچھا لگتا ہے وہ شاید آج کنڈل پہ پڑھیں, یو نو ہارڈ کاپی شاید کم پڑھیں, بٹ آئی نو ا لاٹ آف پیپل ہو اسٹل لائک ٹو ریڈ, لائک دیٹ ٹچ اینڈ فیل آف اے بک.
اینی بک آن یور میموئرز اور سم تھنگ وچ وی کین ایکسپیکٹ لائک
میں, میری عمر کیا لگتی ہے آپ کو میموئرز کے لیے؟ ٹائم ہو گیا سمیت,
چلتا رہنا چاہیے ایسا
فی الحال تو نہیں.
اچھا ایک چیز, دو چیز مجھے پوچھنی, ہیڈ یو ہیپن ٹو واچ آسکرز؟
یس آئی ڈیڈ. آپ کا نمبر آئی تھنک دنیا بھر کے لیے بہت ہی ایک انوکھا انوبھو رہا. ایسا بھی ہو سکتا ہے یا پھر کچھ بھی ہو سکتا ہے, پروف ہو گیا وہاں.
صرف وہیں پہ ہوتا ہے یا ہمارے یہاں بھی ہوتا ہے؟
یو نو ہوتا یہ کہ آف کورس ہمارے یہاں ہم جانتے ہیں, پر ہمیں ہمیشہ لگتا ہے کہ نہیں وہاں ایسے نہیں ہوتا ہوگا, پر وہاں بھی ایسے ہوا.
ایک چیز اور مجھے چیز بتائیے پلیز, اف یو تھنک آنسر اٹ, گل مہر کون آپ نے پڑھا ہوگا ان کے بارے میں جو چل رہا ہے, آپ کی پرتیکریا کچھ اگر تھوڑا بہت اگر آپ کچھ پرکاش ڈالنا چاہیں.
یو نو میں اس کے بارے میں زیادہ نہیں کہنا چاہتی, بیکاز I think what we really need to respect is people's freedom of expression. Usne kuch kaha, kisi aur ne kuch kaha, sab apni apni jagah sahi hai, apne apne jagah sahi hai, par main isme aur zyada nahi kehna chahti, because I think everyone has a right to express what they feel.
Violence theek hai, violence nahi hona chahiye.
Of course nahi hona chahiye, bilkul koi bhi nahi violence, koi bhi nahi chahta.
میم کور اگر ہم دیکھ رہے ہیں تو چھپکے سے ہمیں لگ رہا ہے کہ یہ شاہد اور کنگنا ہے, کور کے بارے میں ذرا بتائیں.
یہ آپ بتائیں پلیز,
یہ ہماری انٹینشن بالکل نہیں تھی کہ وہ کسی کی وہ کچھ کسی کے ساتھ ریزمبلنس ہو ان کی.
وی وار ٹرائنگ ٹو گیٹ دا فیل آف آدتی اینڈ دا مین کیریکٹر اینڈ دیز وار فرینڈز ہو اگریڈ.
بیگم جان ریلیز ہو رہی ہے 14 اپریل کو, اور اس کے بعد تمہاری سلو کی شوٹنگ شروع ہوگی, تو بس فی الحال تیاری چل رہی ہے. You know, Pranay and Shaunak, my stylist, got this for me and I absolutely loved it because there's something very classic about it, which is why I wore it.
Chaliye jaldi se aap Oscars ke red carpet pe aaye hamare liye.
Aaye hai inshallah Oscar leke aao, dua karna yaar.
Thank you bhai. Vidya ji, mai chalti hu aap.
Are
you can have a you can ask for whatever you want. Okay, so since we are all friends and family out here, we would like to welcome all of you to the launch of Namita Roy Ghosh and Sanjay Chopra's The Wrong Turn! Yay! So we're going to get into how they got together and wrote this book, and of course we have a lovely panel of wonderful speakers, and they're going to read excerpts from the book for all of us today. But I think the person who made it all possible, besides the two of you who spent a long time writing it and really slogged, is this man here called Ajay Margo, who's the publisher of Forbes International, the guy who is the most amazing. Let me finish my sentence. He makes the most amazing faux pas. Ajay Margo!
Thanks, Maria, for this lovely introduction. Thank you. Yeah, I'll speak to you later. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you all for joining us this evening to celebrate the launch of our latest publication from Home Books International, The Wrong Turn, Love and Betrayal in Time of Netaji, co-authored by Sanjay Chopra and Namita Roy Ghosh. I am particularly beholden to Vidya Balan, our guest of honor for this evening, Digbanshu Dulia, Anil Dharkar, Arshad Varsi, is yet to come, Maria Goretti, she's here, Tiska Chopra, for being here today. As award-winning individuals of distinction, and of course, I'm so sorry, and Simone Singer. Okay. As award-winning individuals of distinction in your field, and as friends, since some of you have given me a place in your home, and hearts too. You agreed to have a discussion on arguably one of the finest pieces of literary fiction out of India. What could be a better homage to this genre of writing that publishers continue rooting for? I grew up smelling and touching books since my father decided to be part of the book industry nearly 60 years ago. We raced through literary and historical fiction. In hindsight, A Tale of Two Cities, Dr. Zhivago, Gone with the Wind, our very own Rangbhumi, Gabban, Godan, or the plethora of gut-wrenching partition stories. Literary and historical fiction touched our lives either through books, films, or through the television screen that refreshed memories of times gone by. In that lineage, if I may say so, situates the wrong turn in which human beings submit to and assist the push and pull of histories and geographies, set to a perpetual churning by human foibles and needs. As the evening progresses, you shall hear enough about the book to want to know why 1944 was a watershed year for India, how the INA dreamt of freedom at least 3 years before it was actually won, and how the protagonist still found the time and space to love, hate, win, lose, nurture, betray, punish, and pardon. Sanjay and Namita. The book is here and seems almost miraculously so, but thank you for co-authoring The Wrong Turn. Over a drink later in the evening, you may tell me who made the coffee, who wrote the pages, who tore them up and wrote afresh, and who took sides of the protagonist as they almost became flesh and blood. Thank you for journeying together through this marvelous story. A quick read through the first 20 pages, and we at Om Books International knew a story well told from the rest of the stories. So thank you both once again. Launching it in a place called Junkyard Cafe is significant. For that is where we dig into the past and unearth forgotten bits of our lives. Thank you so much, Umang Tiwari, he's my dear friend, and your team for getting us to the Junkyard Cafes. The ambience is perfect for a walk back in time. And I hope you enjoy it. And at the end, do not forget your copy of The Wrong Turn for the right read. It's available outside. Thank you. And have a wonderful evening.
So, somebody gave me a free book. Can I sell it? Okay, so a small little introduction about both our authors sitting here today. And since I've not done my homework, I have it on my phone. So, a little something about Namita. I met Namita, I think, 25 years ago. Okay, I did some of my best ads with her. As you all know, everyone sitting in this room knows Namita. She comes from Kolkata. And she's been playing with birds since she was just a little kid. So the first thing that, one of the first things that she actually wrote was when she was 12 years old and her teacher asked her to write a piece on her most memorable day. And she decided to write about this Russian girl on the last day of World War II. Well, her teacher thought that, oh my God, she's made up these stories, and that was her first rejection. Well, since then, she has not stopped. She's been making up stories, writing screenplays, writing short stories, writing poems. She was somebody who actually wanted to be a journalist, and she stumbled into advertising. And as you know, the rest is history. She was the youngest creative director at HTA. She runs White Light Films and directs and produces for them. As you know, White Light Films makes some of the best ad films in this place. I was lucky enough to work with her. They've won lots and lots of awards. And besides that, she also does a lot of pro bono films for issues that are close to her heart. Various issues like literacy, stuff to do with nature, sexual harassment. But besides all that, she is a real fun person, a foodie, a traveler, and shares something with the other author of the book, that's Buddhism. So Sanjay is somebody who, whoever has an office like 40,000 feet in the air. But Sanjay Chopra does, because he's a pilot. So I believe he does most of his thinking when he's up there in the air, which means I'm not getting onto a flight that has him in it. But having said that, I must say that he is most enchanting when he's telling you about, you know, stuff that happens when he's on flight or when he's just generally talking to you. He kind of grabs your attention and makes you listen to all the stuff that he wants to tell you about. And his writing is like that. It's old world, it's charming, and yet his stories are all so new, so today, so tomorrow probably. And so these are our authors. A big round of applause. Santosh Chopra and Navodar Rao Roy Ghosh. So, can I ask her a few questions?
I'd like to clarify that Arjun said over endless rounds of coffee. Let me tell you, the culprit was single for
that. The culprit was
single. Never any coffee.
There was never coffee.
There was
so,
never coffee.
I just want to ask you, how did you all decide to collaborate on a book? How easy or how difficult is it for two people with an independent thought process to come to a marriage of words and come to a storyline that just resonates so beautifully?
Okay.
There is a mic.
Oh, yes. So, start.
I'll give you this.
Yeah. Check.
Yeah, it's order.
I want a loud enough voice.
Okay.
Switch it.
Check. It's fine?
Level bada, yeah. Body level bada,
check.
Please.
Check. Okay, so I think it started with the fact that we're very good friends. And like she said, we met over discussing Buddhism. So we didn't have many arguments. I think the point was that it was a story that gripped both our, I think, imaginations. It was a story whose time had come, and it needed to be told. And when we did, you know, research, lots and lots of research, because you don't want to make silly mistakes on a subject like this. When we did all the research and we found that there was this little gap in history, why did the INA lose? Why did Subhash Chandra Bose? Why was that battle lost? And nobody really, there were no historical accounts of actually why they lost. And that seemed like a wonderful place to kind of bring in this very, very human story. And it's really, I think it's got a larger scope. It's not just about that battle. It's about war. It's about what happens to human beings, what happens to individual human beings during war. It's about what, in a very kind of large sense, the small little crossroads we all face, and then we take the wrong turn. And so there was a lot of, he was flying, I was working, whenever we were in town together, we would sit, we would talk, we would write separately, come together, discuss, tear it apart, go back. And so it kind of flowed on, and then when everything kind of came together, that just sitting down and the kind of hard work of writing, that took about, it took about almost 2 years.
Wow.
And then it was done, and there was Ajay.
And then there was Ajay. Yeah, but I think that all stories are basically an act of collaboration. And I had the best collaborator in the world, right? And she's beautiful, Namita. I think that ultimately, that, like she said, the story needed to be told, and which was why the characters and the plot line was so compelling that we just couldn't put our pens down or our keys to a stop. And it's about time that we, in this entire narrative of our history, there's everything that we know about Khadi. And I think it's time to salute the contribution of Khaki.
Yes.
So, which is why we needed to tell this story.
So, which is why you chose this particular story?
Yes.
Also, did you choose this because of the gap, or because you are somewhere, you kind of resonated with what the INA stood for. Is that it? What was it about that particular era, which is why you got into
For me, Netaji is a personal hero. You know, we all grew up on that lore, on the history, and all the mysteries surrounding his life and his, you know,
not being there.
You know, and you know, my uncle of mine, he was like one of those Netaji fields. He really like researched stuff and found out, and I think when the idea came that yeah, we're going to write about this, it was like I've always wanted to write about this, always, you know, it was sitting in the back of your head somewhere in your life, and now, so I really believe that, you know, we don't choose the stories choose us.
Yeah.
We are there at a particular point of time when the story needs to be told and it comes into our lives, and then there's somebody who actually becomes, I think, the vehicle. You know, the characters choose us. We think we create the characters, but the characters kind of creep up onto us, and that's how you actually get down to.
I think for me, great time in India's history, untold story and all that aside, it makes for a crackling good yarn. And that's what I'm always excited by. I like historical fiction, but that which reads like a thriller. So it had all the makings of a story like that, which is why I jumped right into it.
This is your third book, Sanjay.
Yeah.
And your first two had also, your short stories have also won awards. I don't know whether you know this, but he's won very lovely awards in the UK and the US. So, you know, being a pilot, I understand that it's autopilot sometimes. So how did you get time out from flying and then trying to catch up on your sleep and write all these amazing stories?
Your checks and the mail stop this.
I'm not getting a check. I can ask you to come back.
No, but I think, you know.
No, but I'm serious. Because, you know, it's such a different place. It needs so much of time. It needs so much of, you know, space in your head. So how did you get into writing?
I think I need to write a book about this, because I now believe, after 25 years of flying, that jet lag does this for you. I think jet lag opens up neural pathways which you never knew existed. And I really have jet lag to thank for it. So, you know, it's the only positive effect of jet lag. So it's physically tough to write in that space. But I think all my best plot ideas, story ideas have come at a time that I've just come back from a flight and I'm still recovering.
So you're in that in-between midnight zone.
Yes.
Nice. So what we're going to do is we're going to introduce the book to you in the form of three tiny little video snippets. So to give you just a feel of what the entire book is about. So please take a look. Can we dim the lights, please? So now we're going to just have a small excerpt from the film, from the book. I'm so sorry, I'm surrounded by so many people from film. So we're going to have Simone Singh, who is going to read for us first.
Thank you, Ajay. I'm still Simone Singh, in case you forget the next time around. Great for reading. All right, here we go.
Can you see through
it? It didn't work out very well, but thank you. Yes, would you please?
That Simone's reading from is when the INA are on the journey, moving towards Kohima, with, you know, for their trip with destiny, and they're passing through these little Naga villages, and it's all the different experiences which they go through during that time. She's going to share one of those.
Captain, get me a troop from that Gurkha unit, the one which came over to our side last week. Yes, sir. Sir, for sentry duty? No, I want them for a really special op. Debraj had a wicked grin on his face and his eyes sparkled with mischief. Bands of dacoits had been terrorizing the countryside around Mamed. The retreating British had freed the inmates of the local prison, and these criminals had now taken to rape, pillage, and highway robbery. They were difficult to track as they just melted back into the jungle after their sorties. Debraj had got an idea on how to stop them. He chose 20 of the Gurkhas, all short and slightly built. When he told them what he wanted them to do, they collapsed in laughter. Gurung, their sergeant, turned red. He was very fair and blushed easily. "You're perfect, Gurung. You'll make a very pretty Lantal." The men guffawed even louder. Lantal was Burmese street lingo for a sexy girl. Debraj's idea was to dress them up as women and use them as bait. The unit barbers gave them close shaves and reddened their lips and darkened their eyes, and they got into their glangs and salaus, native skirts and jackets. Well, something's missing. So they got hold of a crate of oranges and chucked two to each man. Then they were driven off, accompanied by whistles and lewd comments from the rest of the unit. At the local market, they drew a lot of attention, giggling and bargaining loudly. Then, armed with kukris under their salaus and revolvers in their baskets, they boarded a local bus bound for one of the outlying villages. 3 hours after being jostled on the potholed road, the girls hanging on desperately to the shifting fruit under their dresses, the bus was stopped by a group of rough-looking, unshaven men, armed with traditional long knives and shotguns. Licking their lips, they lined up the girls on the side of the road. The leader, grinning through stained teeth, spat out a long stream of tobacco juice as he made a beeline for Gurung, easily the prettiest. As he roughly felt up the sergeant's body, lingering, his fetid breath, smelling of cheap country liquor, making Gurung almost gag, his hand fell on a most unladylike appendage. Frowning in puzzlement, he gave it an exploratory squeeze. That did it. The kukri hidden inside Gurung's jacket came out in a bright silver arc, and the man's throat was slit from ear to ear. With a blood-curdling cry of Ayo Gurkhali, Gurung went into what the Gurkhas call divine frenzy. With his pretty features distorted into a snarl of revulsion, he leapt and slashed the next man across the throat and then pirouetted to plunge his kukri into the next dacoit's eye. Most armies of the world lacked the nerve to face a full-on Gurkha charge. This was just a gang of common criminals. With Gurung menacingly polishing his kukri, the dacoits spilled all their secrets about their hideouts and their spies in the villages. Legends grew about the fair-skinned, beautiful female spirit who lopped the heads off evildoers. Children were cowed into eating up their food on threats of having her invoked. And no bus running along that road was ever stopped again.
Rajat Kapoor, or like the Italians say, Rajat Kapoor.
So Rajat is going to read from the beginning part of the book, where we're setting it up. The whole story started in 2013. The National War Museum in London declared the battle, the twin battles of Kohima and Imphal, as the greatest battle that the British had ever fought. They rated it above Dunkirk and Waterloo. And so when this news came out in Calcutta, 23rd January, Netaji's birthday, in a small little tea shop, some men have gathered, and this is what transpires.
Duralda greets his latest client with obvious fondness. Good morning, Sudipto Babu. So how are things with our favorite young journalist? Sudipto rubs his hands, freezing Duralda. Haru, my boy, one chai. Nice and hot, chop chop. He gestures towards Balaida's open paper. So what's the latest on that chit fund scam? Balaida shakes his head in disgust. That Madan fellow got red-handed. Shameful. Bambulda scratches his stubbly grey beard. Mark my words, what India needs is a military dictatorship, like Pakistan. A strong hand at the helm. No, Dada. Strong hand chan won't work anymore. What we need is a strong foot to give one tight big kick up everyone's ass. There is muted laughter, a shake of heads, a scratching of bellies around the table. The sound of drum beats and shouted slogans from the main road breaks the moment of reflection. Ganesh Babu looks up with exasperation. Now what? Abarki? Duralda gets up and pokes his head round the corner to look down the street. Ah, of course, today is 23rd January, Nitaji's birthday. Ganesh Babu throws his hands up in exasperation. Oh, Re Baba, those bloody clowns will be out on the streets, left, right, marching around in those khaki shorts, causing traffic jams. The old man slumped in the corner, a shadow shape slowly stirs. Oops, I better hurry up then, mutters Bambulda, starting to gather his things. I have to go all the way to the Dalhousie area. The bank is really giving me a royal runaround over my pension checks. Sudipto too starts to take out change to pay Haru. But Ganesh Babu, if Netaji had been there today, this would have been a different country. He had such vision, such plans. Ganesh Babu looks at him curiously. Really? And how would a youngster like you know about Netaji? That's all ancient history. I'm a journal. I make it my business to know. And anyway, he's still relevant today. It's not just me. Every Bengali, every Indian should know what Netaji could have done. Balaida, who has been engrossed in his paper, suddenly slaps one page. What a coincidence. Here we were just discussing Netaji and see, there's a big article on him. Something about Imphal and Kohima. The old man sits up. The Irani glass rattles against his plate. Ganesh Babu is skeptical. Written by some party bigwigs Chamcha. The Communist Party used to hate him when he was alive. But now they blow conch shells and clean up the crow shit on his statue once a year and make a big hoo-ha. Balaida shakes his head. No, actually it's written by Thomas Jones, a Britisher, I think. It's about some battle. Here, you read it. He has the paper to Sudipto. Secret files made finally public by Thomas Jones about a battle between the British and the Japanese and Azad Hind Forge. Netaji's army. Happened in 1944. For 2 weeks, the future of the British Empire hung in the balance, etc., etc. Wow, look at this. Recently, UK's National Army Museum conducted a poll on Britain's greatest battle fought over the last 400 years. Waterloo, Aliwal, D-Day, Normandy, Rostrift, and Imphal Kohima were selected. But to everyone's surprise, the twin battles against Japan, Azad Hind Forge, fought in Kohima and Imphal in India, were voted the greatest ever. Sudipto looks up, his eyes shining. Then he goes back to reading. Most Indians are not aware that one of the bloodiest and most crucial battles of World War II was fought on their soil, which, if Japan had succeeded in winning, would have changed the fate of the Allied forces and maybe the course of Indian history. Ganesh Babu is still skeptical. Just a gimmick to sell newspapers. Sudipto is indignant. How can you be so offhand about this, Ganesh Babu? Look here, it says... Suddenly his hand is jolted. The old man, who has crept up silently, snatches the paper out of his hands. Hey, what the... But he falls silent. A demented spark lurks just under the surface of the old man's milky eyes. He clutches the crumpled paper to his chest. His other hand, shaking, palsied, is raised to fend them off. Part in imperious command, part in trembling entreaty. Slowly he backs away, shaking his head. Then turns toward the murky light coming in from the street and holds up the paper. He reads silently, his lips moving imperceptibly, whisper of sound and breath. Balaida makes a silent but universally rude gesture, tapping his index finger against his temple. Bonkers, lost his marbles, it says. Haru stifles a giggle. The fog has thickened again and inside the tea shop, there is a hush. Then the old man sighs, looks up. The rheumy eyes peer at them over the thick wireframe spectacles. The ghost of a smile appears on his seamed face when he speaks His voice is hoarse, strained, almost as if he hasn't used it for a really long time. Finally, finally.
Thank you so much, Rajat. And now, finally, we have the girl who makes her path wherever she goes, Vidya Balan.
Firstly, good evening, everyone. And congratulations to Namita and Sanjay. I was asked outside, you know, why did you agree to read the book today, or why did you agree to be here today? And I've done a lot of, many ads with Namita and Shubir at White Light, and I was petrified of them as a model. So the moment I got a call from Namita, it firstly took me a day to return the call. Now you know why. I thought, you know, I didn't know what she was going to say. And then she said, you know, I've written a book, and will you launch it? Before she could complete her sentence, I said yes. But, you know, this book is of course called The Wrong Turn.
You're in very good company. 50% of the people
here. No, but I must tell you that, you know, the book is called The Wrong Turn, but ironically, my life as an actor took the right turn working with Namita and Shubir. I remember, you know, I thought acting was about a pretty face, and okay, I did think I had a pretty face back then. But, you know, I thought that's what it was about, and I was doing a lot of ads, and then we went to Rajkot for an ad film. It was about a bike. I don't want to name it for obvious reasons, but we were doing the ad, and you know, both the male model and me just couldn't get the moment right. It was about this man, you know, who's just come back from the army and who gets a call. There's a message on the radio calling all army personnel back to the front. And we just couldn't get it right. And I remember getting fired by Namita and Shubir. And I remember, then, you know, I somehow got the shots right, and then there was a shot, there was a hand shot, and normally they have hand models to do it. So, you know, I hadn't really manicured my fingers or anything. I hold the transistor and she fires me. She says, your nails are chipped. And you know, you're firstly this a woman in the village, you're not going to have such long nails, and then, you know, to make matters worse, one nail is shorter than the rest of them. I was mortified, you know. I went back into the room, I had tears in my eyes, and I said, what the hell, why is she? But when I came out, she actually had this chat with me, which just made me look at everything very differently. It was actually that ad film, and I've never had a chance to thank you personally for that, but thank you so much. Because, you know, during that shoot, she said, it's so important for an actor to just soak in experiences of all kinds, whether you like it or not. You know, keep observing people, read the newspapers, read books, watch plays, movies, listen to music you like and don't like. Just keep yourself open to experiences. That's when you'll be able to feel a moment that you, you know, haven't experienced personally. And I think that changed a lot for me, and which is why I'm here today to say thank you more than anything else, and all the best to both of you. Sanjay, you're a bonus. I know you're better half. very well. And I was thrilled to know that you've co-authored the book, and all the best to both of you. That's a long speech. Should I even read now?
Yes. You're supposed to say yes.
Yes.
So, Dev Raj is one of the characters, and Aditi is the woman, the one woman in the book. And Debraj is injured, he's in hospital, and Aditi's been looking after him, and this is a section from there.
Debraj felt restless. He had slept the whole afternoon and now, in the evening, felt cooped up. Aditi had been completely avoiding him the last few days. The Malay nurse, he kept forgetting her name, had taken over. Her rather rough, matter-of-fact ministrations, very different from Aditi's careful hands. He was irritated by Aditi's absence, her recalcitrance, her refusal to meet him halfway. To hell with her, Prissy missed two shoes. He rang his bell, but no one came. Where was everybody? He struggled to ease himself out of his bed and managed to collapse onto his wheelchair. Outside, the cold antiseptic smell of the floor cleaners made him sneeze. He could see the nurse's station at the far end, light spilling out of an open door. But he didn't fancy talking to any of them. He felt a cool current of air coming from somewhere. He swerved and headed for its promise of freedom. A veranda led out onto a small walled garden. Crickets chirped. The oversweet fragrance of some nocturnal flower, the damp smell of earth, filled his lungs. It was turning dark, twilight softening the outlines of the little stone cherub perched under a drooping willow. He suddenly thirsted for a stiff drink and a cigarette. He thought of Nishanko, how he would never light a second cigarette from his match, calling it sniper bait. One strike, the enemy can't draw a bead. But you pass the flame to another cigarette, he's got you in his cross sights, and poof, your head bursts like a watermelon as you bend down to cup the light. All of a sudden, he missed Nishanko, missed his dry, reserved manner, his down-to-earth words. He missed Pandeji, and even the ever-disapproving Captain Nawaz. He missed the male ribaldry and the clean single-mindedness of soldiers engaged in battle. He realized that none of them had tried to find out how he was, that the knowledge had been secretly rankling inside. Did no one care? Or maybe they didn't even know where... he was. A shadow darkened the doorway. A figure in white, a nurse, stood there, shoulders hunched, indistinct in the twilight. "Hello?" Devraj called out softly. She straightened up, stepped into a spill of light. It was Aditi. He was absurdly happy to see her. She drew in a deep, shuddering breath. "What are you doing out here?" "Following doctor's orders. Doing my evening constitutional." "Where's everybody?" He was glad to have her back. She shook her head as if trying to clear it. "One of the operations up north, it went wrong. We've all been busy." "Are you okay?" A long sigh of bone tiredness. She absentmindedly started peeling off surgical gloves. He saw they were soaked in blood. He noticed that she still had a surgical mask curled around her throat. Without looking at him, she started to talk in a flat monotone. "They tell us it's useless, you know, to waste time and supplies on the ones who are too damaged. It's so tough to get medicines, morphine. We're always running short. So who deserves them more? The ones who can continue to fight, or the ones who have already fought so hard and sacrificed so much? We make that call every night. We play God." He wheeled his chair, reached out his hand. She took it absentmindedly, slowly sliding down the stone wall till she was resting on the stone flags, propped against his bandaged leg. He cupped his hand on the nape of her neck. She leaned back, accepting the solace. "They accept our professional judgment silently. No complaints. But their eyes, they brush, their eyes. What happens if we're wrong? Maybe if he'd held on a little longer, given him some more penicillin, maybe..." "Who did you lose?" "Too many. Anwar Qasim. A big bull of a man. A laugh like a big drum. Told me to give the morphine to the bachas, the kids. Went so gently into the night with his God's name on his shattered lips." She started to cry softly, hot, fat drops. He leaned forward and enfolded her, burying his face in the springly, curly, cloudy mass of her hair. She smelled of hay, spring water, oranges, and lye. They remained like that for a long moment. Then she stirred, turned her face up to his. He stared at her at the wide apart eyes, the dark bruises of weariness like smudged coal underneath. She stared back. His hair had grown back curly. He had not been shaving, and his cheeks, hollow, thin, were shadowed with the beginnings of a beard. The irises of those grey, gold-flecked eyes were wide open, dilated like a cat's. The scar across his forehead, still healing, was a livid pink. She reached up to touch it with her fingertips. He held them, brought them to his lips. Then they kissed, chased at first, the merest brush of lip against lip. Then exploring, feeling their way, then the shock of hunger, and finally the plunge into the wet, secret recesses of each other. It was her first kiss.
You can't come late and say such things. Okay, so what we're going to do now is we are going to launch the book. So we would like the book to launch. Mr. Umang Tiwari, Ajay Mago, Mr. Dharkar, Tiska Chopra, Rajat Kapu, Vidya Balan. Is there anyone else that I have missed? Please, they won't give me my glass of wine if I miss anyone out. So I'm Simon Singh. So here it is. I don't play the drums, but da 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 da. Come on, guys! There is The Wrong Turn by Sanjay Chopra and Namita Roy Ghosh. Parsi. Can you please take your seats? We're just waiting for Nomita and then we are going to start our...
Can we have some silence, please? Thank you very much.
We'd also like to say thank you to...
Request everyone to come and please sit down.
अरे
मैं माइक में इसको भी बोल नहीं रहा हूँ चिल्लाने का नहीं मेरे ऊपर ये माइक में रहता है ना बाकी इसका एरिया
I want to join her party.
Good evening, everyone.
So unless everybody pipes down, I'm going to say good evening one last time.
Good evening, everyone. Good evening. She wanted to be a
teacher. She became an actor. Ram,
okay, so there's a couple of questions that are running amok in people's heads, particularly mine. I want to ask the panelists here about something that concerns the book and is the subject matter of the book. One of the things is that is about betrayal. So I'm going to start with my dear friend Arshad and ask him, has he ever been betrayed?
Yeah, has he ever been betrayed? Oh my God, betrayed sounds like such a solid word, no? Betrayed, it's like you go against your country and all that. Well, not in that large sense, but I think all of us have been betrayed somewhere, somehow, in some way. I can give you an example. Recently, Akshay Kumar betrayed me. That was my fate, he took it away. So yes, we get betrayed pretty much every day. And also depends on the profession you're in. Your profession demands betrayal. No, I wasn't. This is without it. Talk to me after the drink.
Have you ever been betrayed?
All the time.
All the time, yes.
You can't just get away with that, you have to be a little bit more explicit.
Yes, you get betrayed, but now because I've seen the film industry from very close proximity and since I'm an outsider, I'm not a Bombay boy, either. I'm from the film industry. So I'm kind of used to it now. So I've built my own fort and kind of protect myself from getting betrayed by partners, by producers, by everyone. But it's nice. Makes you strong. Like the INA, I mean the context of this book, they were betrayed all the time. They gave us a freedom.
Mr. Dharkar.
Well, my betrayals are very tiny. I won't even call them betrayals. One is betrayed by the weather, one is betrayed by the traffic. One is betrayed by...
demonetization.
A good one. One is betrayed by people not smelling good, and so on and so forth. Sometimes you're betrayed by a whiskey which promises much more than it is. I noticed you wrote your book with single malts. I started the single malt club in Bombay. And sometimes you get a fake single malt, which is not so nice. So that's a betrayal.
It's probably the worst kind.
Namita.
Betrayal. Yeah, I think the biggest betrayal, I think, is what we do to ourselves, isn't it? When we kind of, I think, give up, tell ourselves lies. I think New Zealand, absolutely. So I think you can only get betrayed by somebody if somewhere inside you've kind of given up. Otherwise, I don't know if you can really be betrayed.
No, but that's a profound one. What you just talked about.
And, you know, I think betrayal is also very subjective. It could be betrayal to you, and for the other person, it's a judgment, it's a decision. So it's all relative. Right?
No, but what Namita's face about, I think, is very profound, simply because I think that's the betrayal which happens the most often. Because you can think of a goal, you want to do something, and you let yourself down, so you betray yourself. And I think most of us do that all the time, and we do it to ourselves.
Right? So what you're saying is that we set ourselves up for betrayal. Yeah? Is that what you're saying? That we sort of want to believe the other person and we willingly go down that path and we say, somewhere in the back of our head, we do know.
Why don't you ask Sanjay?
Very scared of the answer.
Like the whole of America has just betrayed themselves.
Arshad is on a roll. I think they should just give
him power. I will arrest it straight after this discussion.
And if you hang on long enough, he'll reveal all. So yeah. So yes, but I strongly resonate with what he said about malts and how they can be single or otherwise. But I think that yes, I think the human condition, we set ourselves up for betrayals because we are preconditioned to it. We have these false sense of entitlements, etc., etc. And what Arshad said is very right, that one man's betrayal may be another man's nationalism or another man's patriotism, you never know. Then, of course, Arshad would agree with me on that.
I agree with everything you said.
Okay, so agree with this one. I know that it's coming from your heart. So when we were, of course, young and foolish, we used to feel that...
last year.
Yes, that was this.
Last year.
We used to feel that being true to one person is a betrayal of an entire gender. So, you know, we are now old and
we were young and foolish earlier. We're young and foolish now, we're old and writers.
Right after this panel, you're going to get the divorce papers. That's going to be the end of that. And okay. So what the next question is a little bit more serious, which is also sort of contained in the book, is the idea that is history fact or fiction? Just to elaborate a little bit, historical fiction is making a huge sort of, there's a revival of it worldwide. Everyone's picking little gaps in history and making mega series, mega books, mega films out of it. I'd like to know from our amazing panelists, Tishu, you've done a film which is in editing right now on the Red Fort Trials. So what part is fact, what part is fiction? Is history someone's opinion? Is it a victor's manuscript? Is it in fact actual documented history or just one side of it? What do you think?
You're right, most of it is the victor's manuscript. And usually history is written in different ways. Sometimes history is written backed by a certain kind of ideology and philosophy. So. I kind of, if I like an ideology, if I believe in an ideology, I'll read that author's history. The history which is being rewritten right now, I don't agree with it. So
can you elaborate on that?
Let's not elaborate on that. But as far as the Ainik is concerned, and I'm making this film called Raag Desh, the Song of the Nation. It's about Netaji's international army and how eventually the army, the INA lost, but they won us our freedom. It's very ironical. And the whole mystery behind Netaji and what happened to Netaji, which is there so much in the news these days. But I'm not really interested in what really happened to Netaji. I'm more interested in what he did for the country. So history is interesting. I've been a history student from Allahabad University. I've read some very serious history. So history is interesting because it tells us about our past, and if we don't learn from history, we're
doomed to repeat it.
So I kind of really respect history, and I read all the time. This subject really interests me. I don't really read fiction too much. I only read politics and history and changes in society. So history in all forms is interesting, but if it is backed by an ideology which you believe in, it makes it more interesting.
Mr. Dharkar, you were with NFDC when Gandhi was commissioned. What do you think about the film version of history? Is it okay to fictionalize? Recently we had an incident where a filmmaker was severely traumatized on his sets because he was sort of taking one side or portraying something. So what is your take on that? Should authors, filmmakers be allowed to give their version of history, or should they stick to facts? Are there in fact any facts?
But particularly about Gandhi, I think Richard Attenborough approached his subject with great reverence, and that shows through the film. For him, Mahatma Gandhi was really the Mahatma, and I think that's the reason the film worked, because he made Gandhi such a great man, and the incidents were played up so very well with the right kind of sentiment and emotion. Now, if you set out to do the other kind of Gandhi film, which Richard Attenborough obviously wouldn't have done, but someone else could do, where you show a lot of the things that Gandhi did which were not Mahatma-like, and we know all about those, a lot has been written about it. Unfortunately, we now live in an India where that would not be permitted. Mahatma Gandhi is worshipped only, by default now. No one actually follows anything Gandhi has taught. But you try and make a film about Gandhi's his very strange ideas about relationships, about diet, about morality, etc. You make a film about that, and immediately all the hackles will rise, Mr. Nihalani will ban it. So this is where I think we need to change the thought process in our country. We need diversity of opinion. We need to see any man, however great he is, has a negative side. And we should be able to see that. We should be able to talk about it. We should be able to depict it in a movie. As it is, history is never truly, is never the truth, in the sense that it is the truth as seen by a particular historian. And as you were saying, there is an approach, which is a philosophical, political approach. You could have a leftist history, you could have a right-wing history, and so on. Therefore, you need several histories about the same subject to actually get at a true picture.
And an evolved society would allow for that sort of diverse narrative to emerge.
An evolved society would. I mean, we always joke about Trump. But look at the way Trump is vilified now, and the way people joke about him, at the Oscars, the fun they made about him. Can you imagine similar fun being made about any of our leaders? Just wouldn't happen.
India,
try and make jokes about Narendra Modi.
I always say that India is the funniest country with no sense of humor. Very profound. Take your time to get it.
Ashan.
Yeah. Don't ask me anything sensible. Please do. She's very serious.
Catch
me
after.
Drink something.
Yeah, after a drink, I was going to say. So, films, books, art is supposed to hold up a mirror to society and provide a Rashomon-like perspective to an incident or whatever's happening in society at that point. If one side of that is shut down and only one side of the narrative is allowed to progress, then that becomes somebody's version of history, something that we've been reading for many, many years. So, your version as an artist.
Repeat that, please. You know, like it's you know, I have to say, book is one person's point of view. I mean, everybody's point of view, and a film is a director's point of view. So I think somewhere that is what it's all about. So unfortunately, in the country we are and the way things are, movies, books, and any kind of idea has become a third person's point of view. Somebody else decides what you should write or you should do or you should think. It's a very confused situation. One has to work around creativity. So it's very hard to answer a question like that. It's very difficult. See, I'll tell you honestly, we are in a position, we are in time where you have to value, weigh every word you say. It's a horrible time. It's not good. It's not good.
Recently, the Oscars happened, and there was such a huge sort of uprising within the artistic community, whether they were cinematographers, actors, writers. Everyone was up in arms against what's happening with the policies of Trump. And Asghar Farhadi, who won the best foreign film, actually didn't come to the Oscars too. So as artists, as writers, as artists, should we not actually take some sort of a stand? But I think we're all really worried about our reputations and our bread and butter and all of that, and we don't actually take a stand in India about something like that. What do you think is the reason for that? Why are we not taking a stand?
We are too frightened and too small a community to take a stand for anything. We are not built to fight. We are not built to create riots. We are docile, soft, artistic people. We are not the kind of people who will throw stones at people. We are not the kind of people who want to enter a place and create a riot. Therefore, we have to be quiet, unfortunately. I wish the government, the law would help us out. If tomorrow we have the whole artistic film writers community gets together, hires a whole lot of goons with sticks and stones, and we start protecting ourselves, there'll be no difference between anybody else and us. That's the sad part. I wish we had the government who would back us up, because we are not fighters.
Why would the government back you to talk against the government? That is a very unrealistic expectation. You have to, as artists, whether you're an actor or a writer or a director or whatever, you have to raise your voice. And I think when the conditions in the country are hostile, you need to raise your voice louder. And you can't wait for a special dispensation to do that. It just has to come from you. Has to come from each other.
Many a times the industry has raised voices, but nothing happens. Absolutely nothing happens.
During the emergency, 1975, Devanand Saab floated a party against the Congress. Openly. Or bahut sare members the unke, but nothing happened to the party because Congress also lost. But so he had the guts.
You know, Arshad, sorry. So I think as artists or writers or filmmakers, so we're not trying to start riots. We're not trying to... So what can we do? We tell stories. And just yesterday we were talking that actually human civilization started with telling stories. When we started to tell stories, we moved from being one kind of species to another. Stories are the biggest currency that human beings have. And that's what we deal in. So when we start telling stories, maybe, you know, cleverly, surreptitiously, but when we start introducing ideas, when we start introducing other points of view, that's the kind of thing that I think artists can do. We can't go out there and start riots.
Stories are told to children by their parents right from birth. I don't know how much it has helped. We are not getting any better. You know what I mean? I mean, if telling stories, if that would help, I don't know what would help. I mean, we've gone to another level of discussion. But the fact is, I'm a bit, I'm not very happy with the way things are. So it hurts me.
Yeah, but you know, you're also wrong in expecting immediate results. Immediate results never come. It is attrition. You have to chip away. You have to keep chipping away. I think the central message which has to go out, particularly now, is that patriotism is not just a case of waving your flag and becoming ultra-nationalist. Patriotism, the real patriotism, also involves correcting the faults of your society, which is being critical about the society and all the wrongs in society. And our society is not perfect by any means. There are a huge number of things which are wrong with it. So if we talk about it, it is not being unpatriotic, it is being very patriotic.
So coming back to the book, this book raises the much needed dialogue and discussion about, I'd like the authors to jump in at this point, and talk about the narrative that this book has, because I'm married to one of the authors, so I have a little insider view into the book. So one of the narratives that is part of the book is the contribution that Bose and his men in khaki had to the freedom struggle. Sanjay, Namita?
So there's large parts of our history, like they were talking about history backed by an ideology or a philosophy. But I think that there's a real danger in letting history serve an ideology. Because the moment you treat history as a slave or a servant, and you send it out in the world to do your bidding, then you're only propagating a certain kind of ideology, and more often than not, imposing it on everybody else. I think we are in the real danger of that happening all the time. And again, I think it's the human condition. Humans acting in groups always try to impose their will and their opinion on others. This entire book actually started when we read an article in the London Telegraph, which was very, very strange, because in 2013, the National War Museum in London had this survey, and they had military historians do this survey, and they came out with an amazing fact, that the Battle of Kohima was the greatest battle that Britain had ever fought, which Namita had spoken about earlier. Now, this is very surprising, because Britain in the European theater has fought all their major wars, their major battles. One small cantonment town in the northeast, how could it even be possible that Britain or the English considered it to be the biggest battle? So that the entire process for this book, about this book and this story, started from there. And then we started doing research, and we understood that on that fateful day, which was 4/4/44, as in 4th April 44, Britain could actually have lost India. And this is borne out by their communications between Churchill and Mountbatten, who was the commander-in-chief here. And Churchill said that, on my watch, no matter what happens, I would not want to lose India. I don't want to supervise the breakup of the empire. And what had happened is that in 2 days, in those two fateful days, I think the entire history of India actually took a wrong turn. Because if they had won, and they had won at Kohima, the road to Calcutta was open, there was nobody to oppose them, and India would have gone a completely different way. So this backdrop is what really excited us. And so we started asking the attorney, what if it wasn't a straightforward battle, but what if there was a betrayal? What if it was brought about by forces, desperate forces that came together at Kohima, and to vie for the brightest jewel in the crown, which was India itself? And as we know, the history of battles and revolutions in India, betrayal is one strong undercurrent that runs through everything. In India it's famous that not every gun is trained at the enemy. There's been times when we've trained our guns upon each other and ourselves, and brought down great things from happening. So that's how the process for this book started.
I think we were talking about how history has different, there can be different viewpoints of history, and here where I would like to differ, because though of course this was a huge battle, and Britain really got a massive scare and almost lost it. But I think suppose the INA had managed to get into Calcutta, I don't think the British would have been overthrown, because the INA didn't have the strength to carry on and conquer the whole country. What I think Subhash Chandra Bose was expecting and hoping was that India would arise, right, because the army had come in, because the INA had come into Calcutta and Dhaka. But the British had put all our leadership into jail. Everyone was in jail at that time. So without that leadership, I don't know whether there would have been an uprising.
But Mr. Dharkar, you know what happened after the INA lost, and I think one should know this whole history, of course. After the INA lost, the British were very triumphant and they said, we're going to teach them a lesson. So they say that, you know, they chose three men, and Subhash Chandra Bose couldn't have chosen better, because he chose a Muslim, a Sikh and a Hindu, and he put them up for trial. And the British put them up for trial, and the whole point was that treason against emperor. But the point they made was, we are an independent government, we are a provisional government, and we do not owe allegiance to the crown. They actually fought the case, and those men were actually sentenced to death. What happened was, the country actually rose up. Even the leaders, if they weren't around, the Bombay Mutiny happened, and the kind of domino effect that started to happen. And finally they understood that there is actually no way that we can actually stay on in India. So though they didn't win, the point is that the kind of turning point was the fact that they fought. They didn't just lie down, and they didn't just keep on accepting, and they said, okay, it's something. Even at, and what Subhash Chandra Bose keeps on saying, that, you know, that idea that we have to sacrifice, are you willing to do that? So they were willing to do that, and that is what caught, I think, the imagination of the entire country and everybody. From that point onwards, they knew that they could stay on in India. And Sanjay, if you would like to share what you were talking about, that book that you...
So it was, in fact, it reads like fiction. I mean, a really good author couldn't have thought of a better plot than this, because, in fact, Bose couldn't have asked for anything better to happen with what he was trying. And Tishu and I were discussing how ironical the entire experience must have been for the British, because what they were trying to prevent in actually smothering information about Bose and everything else, but when they put these three people on trial, they actually publicized what they were trying to actually keep under wraps. And when that happened, for the life of them, they couldn't have understood, because Bose's main aim was, he knew the INA was too strong, but it was a symbolic force. And he thought that the Indian army, that is the British Indian army, would actually rise in rebellion. They would see their brothers wearing another uniform, and they realized that they were mercenaries, actually. And they would go over the other side, because that was the true Indian army, in his words. I mean, the opinions can, of course, differ. But that never happened. However, because of the Red Fort trials, it all came to light, and India suddenly started becoming patriotic in a different view, in a different kind of way. When their field marshal, Auchinleck, was asked in 1942 that, can you hold India? His reply was, I have no reason to suspect the loyalty of the Indian Sepoy, as they used to call them. But in 1945, when he was asked the same question, he did not reply for a long time. And when he replied, he says, I have no answer to give. I cannot guarantee the loyalty of the Indian Sepoy today, because he has seen what it is to be Indian. So their foundations were shaking. And when the first mutiny, the naval mutiny, happened in Bombay, they realized that they could not hold on anymore. There is a very interesting book which is out now called Holding On to the Jewel. And it's by a British historian who's, again, there's been records that have now come out in the open, and documents and files, secret files, whatever. And it's amazing that the British actually never intended to leave India. And strangely enough, they had earmarked a plot 150 acres in size outside Delhi to keep as their embassy.
a 150-acre plot which would help India militarily and economically. They wanted to hold on even then because they thought that they could give some form of autonomy, people would be happy, and they would never have to leave. So what compelled them to leave ultimately was the fact that they did not have the manpower, the sepoy, the eternal sepoy who guarded every cantonment. They did not have him on their side, and they could not hold on to his loyalty. They decided that before they are slaughtered to a man, which was their nightmare from the 57 mutiny, they better leave. And and their communications that happened at that time bear this out to a large extent.
Just tell you an incident. When the trial started happening, the first day of the trial, when Guru Bakshi, as Mamata said, there were three officers put on trial, a Sikh, a Hindu, and a Muslim. So Guru Bakshi Dhillon was a Sikh, Prem Sehgal, who was Shahid Ali ke nana hai, Prem Sehgal and Shahnawaz Khan, a Muslim. So they were taking the trials happened at the Red Fort, the Salimgarh Fort, and within the Red Fort, there's a POW camp was made, and they were taking inside the truck. So Gurkha soldiers were escorting them along with some British officers. The British officer pushed Dhillon. Chaldi jaloga, he put Dhillon turned and slapped him. This a brief scuffle happened between them. But no Gurkha soldier came up to save the British officer. And then Jawaharlal Nehru, because Jawaharlal Nehru was part of the defense committee who was fighting the case for the INA, he came up and said, "This is the first sign of independence. Today we saw." Because a British officer was, slapped, and none of the Gurkha soldiers kind of came to help. And the trial happened, that was the beginning of the trial. So, actually, INA sahi hua jo kuch hua.
Well, it's about time that people knew this history.
Yeah. But these are the incredible ifs and buts of history. Absolutely. Now, we don't know what would have happened in Britain if the Tories were in power, and Churchill was prime minister, and not Attlee had been the prime minister. Again, we can only guess.
We can only guess, and that is why writing fiction is the best thing possible.
Yeah. And on that note,
and it's not just it's also safe. Very safe.
And on that note, is there anyone who has one or two quick questions to ask the authors, the panelists, or would everyone like to now head towards the bar? Poonam, Maria.
The bar. You will ask me, have the kids gone to sleep?
No. What I want to ask both of you is... yes, this took 2 years to write, and it was about something that was really close to your heart, a story that you said needed to be told at this point of time. As two individuals, was there ever a point when you were writing that you thought that the story had to go a different way, or were you always, on agreement with everything?
Well, actually...
And who won the rounds most of the time?
So what we did when we first started writing was we actually wrote out a screenplay. Before the book, there was a screenplay. Because when the idea came up, we had thought that it would make a great film. So it started with a screenplay. So already there was a structure in place. And as we went along, one of the things I think on which we stumbled was we had researched, but we had thought most of the stuff had happened in Burma, and so we had set a large part of the story, the entire middle, in Burma, and we researched Burma, and the nightclubs, the everything, and then we discovered that no, they were actually in Singapore, so everything has, so that took us back a little bit. Arguments, no, I mean. I think the if you're not perhaps even seeing the same thing, it's I think true of any collaboration that you discuss it, and the person who's making more sense for in the context of what you're trying to do at that point of time, and for the story. I think the whole point about collaboration is you give up your egos for the final baby, you know. So what was good for the story, what would work for the story, what needed to be told, how it needed to be structured, what characters to drop, what characters to introduce, the rhythm of the story, where to hold back. So yeah, so we discussed a lot, and if there were areas of disagreement, we talked it out and then sorted it out.
I want to ask a question, which is that the mechanics of writing, I can understand both of you developing a plot together, but who actually writes?
Yeah.
You know, how can two people share writing? I don't understand. Because there's a uniformity of style.
No, so
it's not as if there are two different styles at once.
Yeah. No, so we had two, there were many drafts made. Sanjay worked on certain sections of it, I worked on certain sections of it. And we worked out the drafts, and then, like I said, we had the screenplay in place. But yeah, at the end of it, one person has to write because there is stylistic language, all that. So, one person did it.
I think also what happened is that since we've known each other for so long, and we've worked on this for so long, that those styles actually merged. And what happened was that there were parts where I thought that I have done a lot of research and I've been influenced by military history and battles all the time, so let me write this scene, this battle scene. And then she would come in and say, no, but it's not making sense like this, I think we should do this. And then we would incorporate that or the other way around. So we would keep coming back and cross-referencing and going back to the same thing again and again, till, strangely enough, a style of its own emerged, which is, you know, like, I think the best part of both our styles.
Who wrote that scene which was read about the kiss?
That was me. Yeah, that was me. But the one about the Gurkhas was Sanjay. About the kiss was
kiss.
Yes, kiss was mine. Yes.
Okay. Hi. Being a writer myself, I believe that a writer has to be first true to themselves. Okay, I believe that you write first for yourself, and then if it goes out to a large audience, that's brilliant. I also believe that we often tend to romanticize the past. And by the past, I mean history. So my question to you is, how much of the fact did you keep as fact? How much of it did you actually fictionalize so that it went under the genre of historical fiction?
There was no actual effort made to achieve any of those ends there. But fiction writers are not really duty-bound to report in the sense that you could actually stick to facts all the time, but then your narrative would read like a lecture on history. And then what would happen is that you'd completely leech all vigor out of your story. You know, you'd make it sound so boring and tepid and probably not engaging or exciting. On the other hand, you can't also be fast and loose with your facts simply because there are real people involved here, there are real incidents that took place. So you've got to strike a balance. That's the most exciting thing about historical fiction, that you find that balance and you find those holes and you spin a yarn through them.
Yeah, and
how much creative license do you take in something
like
this?
So I think the broad strokes of history, what happened, the fact that Netaji went to Tokyo, that he went to Singapore, what happened in Singapore, that they went to Burma, what he said at various points of time, all those broad strokes of history are all there. The people, so maybe there's a character who's a composite of three real characters. Or there is a character who's been introduced who we wish was there, who could, you know, do something to push the plot along. One of the, I think, definitely one of the liberties we took was with the Rani Jhansi Brigade, which were behind the scenes. They didn't come up to the main battle lines when they went into Kohima, but our love story had to have her there. So that's one liberty we took, and we said yes, some of them did go into the forward medical stations. So for I think the sake of of what the story needed to say about this one betrayal which stood for so many betrayals, so many ways in which that time and that action was betrayed. So for that, those small little things were taken. Yeah. Anita, you wanted to raise your hand? Yeah.
So, and Anita from Radio 1. Perhaps the last question, because I think everyone's sort of craving a drink.
Thirsty, yes.
When you got down to your research for the book, one of the interesting things was where you sat down and you found historical papers, and Sanjay also pointed out the fact that they burned those papers, so therefore you were not able to fill those gaps. So how did you fill those gaps in history?
So that's actually what made it most interesting. If they had not burned those papers, we wouldn't have been able to write any story. Then that would have been history. So the thing they did, of course, is that they burned those papers and therefore invited legions of writers from here on forward to write whatever they like about that time and whatever interpretation they might have had. So, like I said, we didn't play loose with any facts that actually, of events or characters or people who actually lived in those times. But then we found enough to be able to make a story out of it, and an engaging story, a story, something that reads like a thriller rather than just, you know, something just about history.
Thank you so much. Thank you everyone for being such a wonderful and rapt audience. Thank you, Ashar. Congratulations, Namita, Sanjay. Pictures. Okay, I think the authors and the panelists are needed outside.
Subjects were talked about, and I think that's important, because if the book can create dialogue, can create you know, occasions for people to think about these things and talk about them, I think that's what the most important thing.
And also the book is also going to be a motion picture, that's what you mentioned. So when is that planning?
So it's something that is in the pipeline. We can't really talk about it, but yes, we definitely want to make a film out of it.
And coming soon to a theatre.
And coming soon, yes. But it's a historical film, so it's quite,
yes.
The scale is very big, and so therefore it requires a lot of support.
Also, we want to make sure, as we have with the book, that we don't want to do any kind of disservice to anybody. We want to make sure that we get the facts right, and then we say our story or we make our story around that.
Do you have any celebrity actor, actress in your mind for the film? Like,
well,
do you have somebody
wish list? I would like to have Dev Patel as Nishanko, because I think he has the intensity and I think the idealism that Nishanko stands for. Aditi is. Can you see Aditi?
Well, not as yet. I think it's a little early. I think Dev very easily fits that part. The others would require a little bit of us to.
Nishanko.
Nishanko. Yes.
Yeah. So yeah, it's. I think there's so much talent out there, and so much, because these are all, actually when you look back at it, the story is about very young people, you know? It's about an 18-year-old girl, it's about a 21-year-old boy who's been thrown into battle, into this reality of having to fight a war, and there is a slightly older 24-year-old. So, you know, they're very young people. I mean, it's not an old people's tale, and it's about young people taking their beliefs and going out there. So yeah, there's a big wish list, and would love to,
And there's also the thing that very often, because the story is big and the events that happened were so big, that very often we forget how young those people must have been who took part in those events. So naturally, it's got to be about the sensibilities and you know, the spirit of youth. So that's very important to retain it.
Yeah.
And not like an old man's tale or somebody who's... So that is very important, and that has to be captured right.
Thank you. This is the first edition of the book which is coming up.
That's right.
What are your expectations from the book and your target market?
Well, our target market is almost everybody. Simply because it is for all those people who are interested in historical fiction, and there are lots of people like that. But at the same time, we haven't written it so that it can become overbearing or tedious. So it is in fact for all those who love basically a good yarn, those who love a good story, those who love characters and everything that happens to them, people who believe in love and people who understand that there is a dark side to love, which is betrayal, and people who basically read thrillers, and I think of all age groups.
Probably must become a bestseller in coming days.
Whoa.
Inshallah. And probably somebody has probably already asked you about the scene which has been depicted on the book cover. So how did you zeroed up on that picture?
Concept is love in the time of war, isn't it? And it's stolen moments. When you read the book, the way all their lives are you know, on the brink. Anything can happen. They don't know what they're going into. They don't know what their lives will be, you know, even a month from now. So we've tried to capture the fragility of what they had in the midst of war, and a moment of that peace and that calm which they, you know, try to. And you really don't know, because it's about a love story. It's about it's about a triangle. So who's this? And so it was like keeping it a little open.
It's picture. Almost like you are spying on two people. It's almost like you've parted the bushes and you see this scene happening. It's like that.
Two people.
Aditi, and we won't say who the other one is.
Yeah. And before we take leave and congratulate you. We congratulate you. We just want to know who will be directing the film, like if it all happens.
Well, I'm a director.
Yeah,
no, so I would, yes, love to direct. And so let's see in the future what happens.
Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. Thanks.
Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
बहुत बढ़िया. मुझे एक्चुअली बुक पढ़ने का बहुत इच्छा हो रही है, क्योंकि आई वॉज अ स्टूडेंट ऑफ हिस्ट्री एंड दिस इज सच एन इंटरेस्टिंग प्रेमाइस, यू नो, अ फिक्शन सेट इन अ हिस्टोरिकल टाइम. एंड And also Namita and Sanjay, I think their collaboration as writers and as two intellectual minds will be quite exciting actually. I'm quite looking forward to this work of fiction. अभी आ रही है जग्गा अप्रैल में और टिस्का और मैंने एक ब्रिटिश फिल्म किया साथ में द हंगरी बोल के जिसमें टिस्का है नसीरुद्दीन शाह है नीरज का भी है सूरज शर्मा है मैं हूँ तो बहुत ही मज़ा आया हमें सो या आई थिंक दैट्स ऑल्सो कमिंग आउट दिस ईयर और कुछ कुछ है जो आ रही है देखेंगे आप लोग पर अभी नेक्स्ट है जग्गा शायोनी I think it's always nice to see, to hear excerpts from a book because when you're reading it, you know, you're imagining it, but when you hear the writers sort of read them out or, you know, the panelists read them out, and they have obviously chosen the excerpts keeping something in mind, you know, because you can't really read out the whole book. So that was, that. It always fascinates me. I actually came a little late, so I wasn't there throughout, but whatever part of their conversation and the panel discussion I was hearing, again, you know, during INA, during Subhash Bose's time, this whole, you know, what would a love story set in that time be like? And so that was really exquisite, you know, when you start imagining those things. And the highlight was really listening to these people and the writers, both Namita and Sanjay, sort of talk about their experience and collaborating to write, because it's very difficult to write together and how that process sort of worked out for them. That was really interesting for me.
They're planning a film on it.
Yeah. Me?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And what's the main protagonist?
Ranbir. Ranbir. Yeah, he's my favorite. Hai na? Okay na casting? Chalo, kal chapwa do.
Director Namita ko rakhenge.
Haan? Bilkul, bilkul. Costumes, Shrija kar sakti hai. Tiska is actually very good with styling. She can style the film. No, no, no. We're going to go to the northeast and go to the eastern part of Bengal. Sorry, India and shoot.
Studio
any? Viacom or UTV or UTV is no more, na?
Yes.
Disney. Yeah, Disney. Chalega. Hopefully. Could we?
Happy to see the Academy Awards this time.
I didn't see it, but I saw excerpts and I saw, you know, those clips that keep coming and whatever has happened. And I see what everyone was wearing and, you know, I like to see photos from there. And yeah, I did see some excerpts and some interviews, which were quite cool actually. Yeah, these things keep happening. I mean, you know, it's funny when it happens at that forum and, you know, and the whole world watches it. It's sad because I feel the limelight, moonlight should have been in the limelight at that point and it sort of took away from their moment. But having said that, I think everyone was very gracious about it. Everyone was like quite a sport. And it's actually quite funny, you know, everyone's talking about it. It's given us something to talk about, something fun. So it's fine, I guess, you know, these things keep happening.
India
mein to sabko de dete award na, kisi ko nahi chhodte. So, haan, exactly.
So,
mujhe to, maine aisa hi suna hai. Jo jaata hai, unko de dete. Main to jaati nahi, mujhe nahi pata.
Ek last cheez,
नहीं मैं नहीं बोलना चाहूँगी क्योंकि सब लोग इतना कुछ बोल रहे हैं मुझे कुछ नहीं बोलना है वो एक्चुअली मेरे कॉलेज से LSR से और आज ही जो इंग्लिश डिपार्टमेंट है LSR से दे हैव कम आउट विथ देयर कमेंट एंड आई थिंक इनफ हैज बीन सेड आजकल ये सोशल मीडिया में ना सब कुछ बनने से पहले खिचड़ी बन जाता है सो आई थिंक द लेसर वी स्पीक अबाउट द बेटर ऑनेस्टली नहीं बिल्कुल बोलना चाहिए बट नाउ यू नो दिस इज एवरीवन हैज एन ओपिनियन राइट एंड अदर पीपल हैव एन ओपिनियन अबाउट योर ओपिनियन सो it's just too much, I feel, and it's a part of the it's part of the time we live in, you know. And but I don't want to comment anything because it's just going to keep getting, you know, you are going to make something out of it. Oh, Shayoni has said this, and I don't want that at all. So I have nothing to say. Just that whatever is happening, we'll see. We are getting to see, and yeah, just log on to your Twitter, and you will see enough. Bilkul bhi nahi. But you know, the thing with trolls and threats and all of that is it's completely unnecessary. It's in very bad. I mean, it's really wrong. Yeah, apart from that, I don't think like everyone should feel safe and everyone has the right to express their opinion, you know, and that shouldn't be tampered with, I feel. You have the right to speak your mind, and so does he, and so does every single person who lives in this country. And it's part of our fundamental right, you know, freedom to express. So that shouldn't be tampered with, and everyone should have the right to freely express themselves, you know, and that's all I think that we should really be concerned about.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.